Good evening. I'm very glad to be here. When Young Cheong first spoke about this project, his main concern was the treatment of international students at a college level. He wanted to bring out the special circumstances that international students faced as they maneuvered through the CUNY system and at Brooklyn College especially. So we will present our film, A World Within, which talks about diversity, and especially among the Asian students of today. Enjoy, please.
Diversity, globalization, multiculturalism. To the average person, these words may not have the same intimate meaning that they may have for those who live it every day. To many people, these words are just words, and yet to others, these words are a way of life. This documentary will focus on a group of people who experience the effects of diversity every day, college students. In particular, students who have chosen to attend Brooklyn College in the City University of New York.
In terms of diversity, is that they want to explain it to you, that they're very open. It's not like you see a lot of people that are different cultures and they form their own cliques. Everyone's very open and they all talk with each other, and so it's a very open relationship.
It was funny because when my Chinese friend had a baby, you know, I said, Let us be your godmothers for your daughter. And I said, even though I'm Jewish.
And I really enjoy learning about them, about why they act the way they do sometimes.
One of the professors I met, he was Asian because I was trying to go to China for this summer. And he was so helpful.
We will explore a movement within CUNY that hopes to mobilize Asian and Asian American students who want to become integrated, yet maintain their diversity and cultures. These are among the latest ethnic groups who have historically fought to be recognized and valued within a college community as well as their neighborhood community.
Coming to Brooklyn College is the first experience I've had with, you know, the diversity of different cultures, different types of people.
You know, there was someone from South America in my class. There were two Jewish people in my class, someone from France, an Hispanic person, an Italian person, and it's like we're all sitting and talking about foreign policy. And
from the transition to high school to college and then to here, I don't really see much of a difference. I've been around diversity my whole life, so.
Yeah, I got my degree at Kingsborough and now I'm back here because I've come full circle to where I understand better the diversity. I left because I felt that it was just too much going on, and now that I'm older, I feel like I can benefit from, you know, knowing other people and other, you know, cultures.
Brooklyn College is a great school because there's a lot of different cultures, and it's very diverse. It's a more comfortable learning environment, and it's really much easier for students to be around different kinds of people, and it's easier for them to learn things that way, just in general.
Approximately 17% of current CUNY students are of Asian heritage. These students represent an ongoing reality of success stories while facing problems of cultural differences, language barriers, and the simple struggle of separation among the various groups.
International students, particularly Asian students, are known to be very diligent, very cooperative, obeys rules because they don't want to let their parents down. Their parents work very hard to enable them to get an education.
I have a lot of hardships after I came to the United States because, you know, I am originally Korean and I am speaking Korean language, not English, and that was my second language. So I had great hardship to speak in English and really hard time to get familiar with this American culture as well.
I'm not really used to saying too much in class because I'm not used to disagreeing with my professors, and I'm not really used to expressing my opinions because of how I was raised and pretty much just in general about my culture. I tend to be very shy, and unless I really have to raise my hand, I do, but it's pretty hard for me to do so, and I just usually just sit back and kind of listen during class time. I don't really raise my hand that often.
American culture, we're taught from young, you know, you have the right to speak your mind. You must voice your opinion and all of those things. And it's not disrespectful when you express your opinions to your elders, as long as you say it in the right manner. And I think mainly, probably in Asian culture, it's better just not to say anything, and that's the way you respect your elders.
They cannot express themselves, and because they don't know the American system or the school system of like who to go to. They might not know that there are special services that they could take advantage of, you know, and or if something happens to them, they don't know that they could complain, because maybe in their home country you would never complain, or they think that, well, I'm a guest here in America, so I should just take it.
Yeah, I came here. The first place I learned this was like Connecticut, and all people, like all my classmates was like Americans. No, we only have like 10 Asians. Yeah, so it was like only 5 of them was Chinese, others are Korean, Japanese. So like we have a difficult language like to communicate.
Mostly Asian foreign students are very, very hardworking and very well prepared academically, you know? But most of them having hard time in communication, you know, language skills are not really good. Very few are very up to the level of like a normal smooth conversation with Americans, but many of them having a problem to speak, you know, English fluently.
Students from Japan and Korea had great difficulties understanding what is said to them, and also great difficulty in speaking.
Foreign students, international students from all different backgrounds and you know, all over Asia, I think it's much more difficult for them to be able to attend school in the USA financially, also to get admitted in general, to cross. There are many, many more hurdles for them to cross to be able to come, so I think they are a very special group.
International Asian students face many difficulties here in their attempts to further their academic careers. CUNY is aware of the typical problems that these students face, and they have provided many programs and services that can make their academic experiences much easier to handle. Faculty and staff at Brooklyn College, through their experiences, have learned different ways to properly teach international students so that they receive the full benefit of their education.
So what my thoughts are, if we have them too close on the edge, it looks like they're columns up and down, and it shows the fact that there's a big empty space in the middle. By zooming out a little bit and keeping them a little
further. I've been teaching the CUNY system for about 3 or 4 years now. I've had a lot of experience with international students, a lot from Asia, some from Africa, some from Europe. And I found in the classroom, the international students are a bit more attentive than American students. They seem to have more desire to learn the concepts, especially when we're getting into some boring media theory or something like that. It's not to say that American students don't work hard, they do, but there seems to be, percentage-wise, a larger percentage of international students who are really hard workers and looking to get ahead in class rather than just do enough to get by.
Skip any kind of fancy intro to it and just make it a simple.
Okay, I'm gonna
do something collectively to all three.
When I first started teaching at CUNY, I found I did speak too fast for many of the international students. And it took me a few weeks, maybe a month, before I started to realize that I needed to slow down for people who weren't native English speakers. What I found worked best is if I asked them during class, does anyone need me to repeat that? Do you understand it? So that way I could make sure that the language barrier didn't affect their education beyond the fact that I was just speaking too fast and needed to slow down.
The good thing about my professors were they gave me more chance to rewrite the papers, or sometimes if my quiz result is really low, they wanted to consult with me and they wanted to offer a different chance for me to take another quiz or make up the quiz. They were giving me more chance so that I can catch up the classwork.
Asian students in the classroom are wonderful students, but they're not exactly the most open with their feelings or emotions. If I sensed that any student had an issue, I would probably be at a loss to find out how to help them. I would have to go to somebody and find out what I could do.
I think the school makes a real effort to meet the needs of these students within the scope of our mission. For example, anything we can do that will enhance the academic experience, that will help them to be more successful in their education, we make a real effort to do.
In the coming semester, I will be teaching at a new school in the South. And the one thing I will take from my experiences at Brooklyn is that the international students, meeting people from other cultures, helps you no matter where you go.
I like being exposed to all different types of ethnicities and cultures, and I feel that it makes the person more well-rounded, and it's better when you go out for a career so you get to get along with everyone you're working with.
The most important service that we have for continuing international students is the Office for Services for International Students with Mr. Ken Forsch, who directs that. He's also involved in some of the orientation for students who are coming to Brooklyn College from another country.
International students that are newly arrived actually are given orientation programs both through the college in general, undergraduate and graduate, as well as the opportunity to meet with the advisor and to come to the International Student Office to talk about their educational planning and the kinds of things they need to do to stay again in status.
Well, we have to consider what students want after they graduate. What do they want to achieve? What do they want to be able to accomplish? And make sure that we're being very thoughtful that the programs we develop will actually help them to achieve those goals.
Brooklyn College has an Office for International Students, a Center for Diversity and Multicultural Studies, the Magner Center, and an ESL department, all of which offer a wide array of services. They have generally been effective in their efforts to help international students adapt to their new lives here in the United States.
For students who need to bring their writing skills up to a place where they are ready to do college work, there's an English as Second Language, or ESL, program which has a summer intensive workshop as well as writing courses that are preparatory for the English 1 and English 2 courses.
Both international students and recent immigrants have a need to upgrade their English language skills. We have courses that are integrated reading and writing skills. We have courses that focus on just one skill alone. Besides attending classes, our students use the writing lab. They work in a small group with tutors. They attend reading lab, again, it's small group work. And we also offer conversation workshops, grammar workshop, vocabulary workshop, so students can attend as many as they wish to or have the time to and make progress as they wish.
So you already have a bachelor's degree,
yeah.
Bachelor of Science?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Yeah, so what do you plan to do career-wise?
It's like, right now I've taken admission in MS, so I would like to be, PhD is my, ultimate goal.
Brooklyn College has, at least in our office, we deal with every semester with somewhere between 500 and 600 students representing about 110 different places. Needless to say, all of these individuals coming, pursuing master's degrees and undergraduate degrees bring a certain amount of energy and vitality to the college. So I think it's very important that students are drawn to the university for the services as well as the excellent programs that we have. Many of the students, as I say, come here because they know that they can get a good, solid, affordable education.
As an international student, I want more help from international office because they know a lot of things, and that must be great if I get more chance to have more information from international office.
We, as I said, in the International Student Services Office, offer students counseling and advisement specifically related to their immigration issues. However, needless to say, students come with other personal problems, and if we identify a situation or something that we can intervene in, maybe refer students to other parts of the college that deal specifically with that issue. For example, many times we will refer students to the Magna Center to pursue internships. If students are having problems, personal problems or anxiety, test anxiety, we'll send the students to psychological counseling, which deals with that aspect of it. So yes, there are many programs at the college to, you know, help aid and support international students who, you know, need that assistance.
And I think these support groups are important because there's a place where people can go to talk about, you know, what's going on at the college, perhaps some frustrations they're having, and they help support people who are already here in the institution.
It might be a very good idea to encourage international students to establish a club among themselves. It's like a support group. When people get together, they can always share information.
Organizations themselves vary from year to year as far as how active they are. You can have a year when their membership is really active, a lot of people come in, and then they graduate, and they don't ensure that other people take over the organization.
If there is a club, like such an Asian club, I might feel really fulfillment of not being myself. I will always feel like I'm not alone.
Another thing that I think would be very valuable would be for the more experienced international students who have been here for a few years to organize themselves with our help into a mentoring network for entering international students.
Students don't feel as if they have equal information. They think, you know, another group of students has more information than they have, and that there's some secret to success here. And so I think we really have to do a better job of making sure that all students have the information they need to succeed here.
Recent increases since the tragic events of 9/11 within the Asian population throughout the boroughs of New York City has led to in-depth research and the creation of organization groups that hope to unite Asians and Asian Americans with their futures here in the United States. CUNY has provided funding for a variety of departments that cater to the needs of a student population that has become increasingly more diverse in the past 20 years, such as the Center for Diversity in Multicultural Studies.
The Center for Diversity started in the early 1990s because there were a lot of racial conflicts and tension in Brooklyn. The center now works to promote cultural understanding amongst the various ethnic populations. And of course, Brooklyn has over 100 different ethnic and linguistic groups. So we work to develop a curriculum, and one of our products was a review of all of the courses at Brooklyn College in Africana studies, Latino studies, studies dealing with Asia, Africa, the Caribbean, different linguistic courses, and we put it together in a multicultural course listing, which seems to be very popular.
When I was a student here, a very small group of students that were Puerto Rican and some African-American students, because they were asking for the creation of an Afro-American Studies Institute, we began to negotiate with the administration of Brooklyn College. So these programs, the Afro-American Studies Program, the Puerto Rican Studies Program, now Puerto Rican Latino Studies, came about as a result of student action. They did not come from the top. It came from the bottom.
Biggest concerns that we have, that I personally have, is the lack of an Asian or Asian American Studies Program. And we have tried for a number of years to get this off the ground with not much success.
Here at Brooklyn College, we are now bringing back the Asian Studies program, So far, we can offer it as a minor, but we are working very hard to expand our course offerings so that it can become a major. Now, this would be very helpful for our new immigrant students from Asian countries as well as international students from Asia, because knowing that in this institution there is a group of people, there is a deep interest in their own country, history and culture.
One of the most fundamental ways to encourage faculty and students to pursue avenues of studies about Asian cultures is to offer courses that explore the different Asian countries.
So just to get an idea, since we have some international students in the class, do you have anything like Jonathan in your country? Do you have anything like an American Idol that's in that type of genre?
No, I'm just kidding. We have a similar program to like American Idol. It's called King of Kings. When I first came to the States last year, I thought I was a stranger. But surprisingly, what I found out was that my professors and friends had more understanding about the Asian culture, and they wanted to know more about it.
By offering the Asian American Study Program, both American and international students benefit from the class experience at Brooklyn College.
Actually, I got to know more about Asian culture by studying in New York with all the other Asian friends and all the other American friends as well.
And when you disconnect, try and stay with them.
It happens to be that what I'm teaching is based on a modern Japanese dance form that came out of World War II, so after post-World War II, as a reaction to what happened. So in that sense, there is some history and sociology that I talk about.
We are part of the American fabric. This country certainly has a long history of immigration, and this country was essentially built by people of color and immigrants coming over here. So Asians and Asian Americans have certainly been part of that history.
Any program that focuses on things like this, it's good because it opens your mind and it allows you to entertain different ideas philosophically, sociopolitically, and it just makes you a more open person. So, of course, I'm all for establishing a program like that here.
Asian American Studies or Asian Studies. There's always been a movement of Asian students that have wanted, every generation coming in, to establish a program, and they've come to us because they want to know, how did you guys do it? How did the African-American studies students and faculty, how did they do it? And I would have to tell you that the times were rather different at that time. I would say that they were tougher, there was a lot more turbulence going on in the colleges, but it was also more opportunity because there was nothing there. And I think the faculty and the administration said, well, there's nothing wrong with bringing in courses that bring in the history and culture of these different groups.
When you have people from different backgrounds, they bring different perspectives and different opinions, and I think that enriches the intellectual environment here. And this is a college, so you want that.
Students in, especially the various Asian American clubs and Asian student clubs got together and really push this as an agenda item, I think that faculty and administration would respond. Now, as I said, I know it's been studied, and I think other CUNY campuses may be more developed in terms of Asian studies than Brooklyn, but I think it's very important, and it's something that we would look forward to working with administrators and students and faculty to make it a reality at Brooklyn College.
To fight this because it's against.
Well, my interpretation here would be this leader represent that spiritual leader that fight against this kind of global project.
The place where I'm from, it's a school that only has 1,500 students, and mostly white. It's like 85% are white, and probably other some small percentage are African Americans or international students. Asian students probably just 5%. And in that school, we already have Asian studies program. We not only have that, we have East Asian languages and literature department, and they are separate. So we have two, with the faculty member are involved with both. with the department and with the study, East Asian studies. So coming from that, you know, environment and to hear Brooklyn is such a huge and actually so part of the CUNY system, and I'm just shocked that, you know, you don't even have an East Asian study program.
One of the issues is you have to have a dedicated faculty from different departments who can come together and put the program in place. And for whatever reason, we have not been able to get enough faculty together. But I think the more important reason is that if you look at Africana studies, if you look at Puerto Rican Latino studies, or any of this, even the Center for Diversity, these grew out of student movements.
I think that our students need role models. I think that's important. I think it's important for all students to see people of various backgrounds in different positions throughout the college, so it gives them something to aspire to. You know, if you have just one group being faculty or being in high-level positions, then without saying anything, it does send the message to minority students that it's hard for them, it's difficult for them, or maybe they can't achieve that. So you want to make sure that you have this diversity at all levels of the college administration and all levels of faculty to say to the students, look, they've done it, this is a thriving environment, and you can do it as well.
Diversity is one of the things that we can celebrate. There is such a wide, diverse student body and faculty and staff as well. So we want to embrace that and to get the positive things from being in an environment like this one.
Brooklyn College is fully aware of the importance of diversity in its academic programs as well as in its student body. Many universities across the country, such as UCLA, Harvard, Washington, and many others, have learned to properly adapt to the effects of globalization as nations across the world are becoming more economically and politically integrated. They have established various types of Asian studies programs that provide Asian language or history courses for American students, as well as provide services for international Asian students. Not only is it important for Brooklyn College to establish its own Asian studies program, but it is imperative that they fully acknowledge the growing number of international Asian students that continue to join here to further their academic studies. This will only help expand the already diverse curriculum that Brooklyn College offers, assuring the appliance of a treasured and beneficial experience not only within the academic sector, but within life's accomplishments.
It's, I think, mutually beneficial because the students may stay in this country and then they become a major workforce.
CUNY, Brooklyn College, the mission is on diversity. Students need to know about other parts of the world. We have a very famous core curriculum, and the objective is precisely to prepare students to know a little bit about many, many areas.
And participate fully. They need more of an understanding of what's in the whole world. And really, what's in the whole world is what's right here.
Why not? Why not bring that diversity out there into the college, you know, to be studied? And to develop professionals that can go back to their communities.
Our hope is that between the college and the community and the extended family, that every international student, as with every student in the college, will have the support that they need to succeed.
Asia, Africa, and Latin America represents 3/4 of the world's population. And you can't be a world-class university and not reflect the entire world.
A lot of colleges are trying to get there. You know, in many ways, we have it here already. But what happens once we have everyone here? I mean, that's, you know, the next step. And so that's where we're going now. We're going to the next step.
CUNY and Brooklyn College will continue to open doors of possibilities for all races, creeds, and global citizens. This legacy is one that will stay with the Asian population, whether they settle here or return to their homelands. It is the legacy of diversity, understanding, and acceptance.
Okay, so how do we start, Kathy? Should we have the question? If you have any question, because this is the deal. Because should we have a maybe presentation a little bit, and then you want to have question, or you want to have question right now? It's up to you guys. Because it's a very small group, so like a really small.
I think we should just do the presentation.
Right. We'll do the presentation first. Okay, yeah. Then. Okay, then can I have a proper presentation? Oh, yes, just turn off the light. It's okay. You can turn off this light. It's fine. Find it. Okay. So the name of the documentary was A World Within. Actually, I was the producer and director. And then Kathy Napoli, who's standing next to me, was a writer. So we spent a lot of time together to develop the story and then also produce this program. So I have to say first, thank you for taking the time to be here. And I hope you found the documentary to be both helpful and informative to you guys tonight. So before I begin, I would like to comment that I have a little hard time to prepare my presentation because I tried to show you all my research tonight, but actually it's not that good tonight probably. So I tried to cut out some information I have it, but I'm gonna explain the process of making documentary tonight. So can I? But at least I have to talk about the Brooklyn College, the fact that we have. So I want to talk about the Brooklyn College first. TV and radio department, because we have about 400 undergraduate students, and then 20% of undergraduate students are Asian students. And then we have also 27 MFA students, and the 14 of whom are from Asian countries, namely like Japan, Korea, also China, also even one of them Nepal. Also, they all come from all over the world. So it's kind of really diversity place. So when I started my research, I was really amazed by the amount of the diversity in just one department at Brooklyn College. So I realized that this is definitely an international institute. So can I see next pages? And then, so this is a little research. So we had the map from, can you find it? It's on the USB stick. This is on the stick, so you can find the action from there. Yeah. You can relink the file.
I don't think the
QuickTime. Oh, the key's not gonna work. Then that's okay. So Kathy Napoli has been the administrative assistant for the TV department for about 15 years. She has witnessed the firsthand the kinds of problems that foreign Asian students are experiencing. So she's always very helpful, and she sees the problem. So she was the one who give them the help, also the solution. So really, because normally most of the Asian students, when they come here, they're so shy usually, because I believe that the reason is that they don't speak English properly, and they don't speak English fluently. So usually they're very shy, they're very quiet. Even though they have a problem, they don't know how to solve the problem. They don't know who they have to talk to. So usually Kathy is the one who usually facing all those problems, and then they see the big like mother of the TV and radio department. She always helps. Same thing with me, because when I was a student about 10 years ago at Brooklyn College, so I had such big problem, because everything was not that easy for me, because I had to adjust myself to be in the American classroom. So the professor speak too fast, and then I didn't have a chance to write down, because I always kind of behind. So when I went to Kathy, she introduced me to other student, so we actually became a friend. And then, you know, there are some also students who are very interested in Asian culture. So I gave them my culture background, and then also they also helped me a lot. But everything, most of the thing was through Kathy, actually. It was my big help. So then, since she realized that, you know, such an international institute, she wanted to, it started from Kathy, and then, because she wanted to apply the grant, which is Asian American the Development Fund, and the CUNY Diversity Project and the Faculty Development Fund, actually 2007. So we sat together, and then we started to make a proposal. And then, you know, we explained our goals and the purpose of our documentary, and they were very happy to give us the fund that we needed. So there was almost 1 year not to go.
1 year's work.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So then, the beginning of 2008, we started our research and then found the valuable numbers. So we started about the Brooklyn. We started actually the New York cities, and then from New York City to Brooklyn. So we found that about 10% of the New York City population is Asian. It's a quite big number. I never realized that even though I was Asian, I was kind of an ignorant guy. So Kathy actually gave those numbers to me, so I was really shocked that, wow, I'm living in almost Asian country here. Because I see many Asians, even though I didn't know that, I had to confess something really stupid thing about me. Because I know the Flushing has a big Chinatown, and then the Manhattan, we had a big Chinatown, but I didn't know that the Sunset Park has a Chinatown there too. So actually those things actually came from Kathy. So I really learned actually while I researched this project. So so when you say Asian, it was very it's not easy to figure out who's Asian, because this is a funny thing, because I have some student, you know, who came from the Siberia. She's not definitely Asian looking. She has a blondie hair, also she has a really blue eyes, but technically, geographically, she's Asian, because she came from Siberia, which is a part of Asia. So then, you know, I tried to be really clear about Asian, also Asian American, also Asian international student. So a lot of things was not that easy to me, because even though I was Asian, but I was not really paying attention until I started making this project. So, can you see next pages? Okay, so this is actually number, okay. Because we found that 35%, almost 0.1% of the Brooklyn College students were born outside of the US. And then go to next pages. And then we find also, you know, this is 2006. Now we have the higher than the 10% number. But 2006, we have about 10% of the Asian students. Now for 2008, we have over 13.4%. So 2009, I'm sure we'll get about 15% of Asian student population at Brooklyn College. So next pages. So this is 2008. So now we have about 15% of Asian students. Also, amazingly, if you see the Brooklyn College, 36%. And then one of the Queens College has about 25%. So this is a quite amazing number for the why we can't have an Asian American study program. Because I believe that public schools should reflect those neighbors and then should reflect the public service. So go to the next pages. And then if you see the next pages here, it's on the before these pages, go back, can you go back? So totally we have about 15% of Asian students at Brooklyn College. But the more interesting is that if you look at here, Brooklyn College, we have 23% of freshmen as freshman Asian students there. So it's more Asian students coming to Brooklyn College these days. So I'm sure it'll be, next year we might have a 30% of Asian students rate.
Unless it's harder to get in.
It's getting harder actually, because they have to pay more than they used to. And it's not free admission anymore, immigration. And then, so once we got all this number, and then we, actually, May 16th, 2008, we attended a CUNY conference on Asian American women. So I met so many people, like educators and their writers, journalists. So I think can go back, go next pages. Okay, skip this one, next pages. Yeah, so if you see all the interview list here, so this is all the interview list. And then we interview about 50 people, actually, about 15 faculties, and then we have 25 students. Also, we have 10 writers, also journalists. So come back next page. So this is actually the conference I think I attended. So I met her, Helen Jia. She's also a journalist and then also a very famous author. So she gave also a lot of the information about this Asian American study program and who's Asian American. Because that's the thing I learned actually from this conference. Let's go to the next pages. So these are all the people we interviewed. Let's go to the next pages. Also, if you see all the different the name here, so this is the one Gia's here, and then this is interesting. Also, the Antonio Nadal, he's running at that point. He was running the Department of Puerto Rican and the Latino Studies, which is a very successful program. So, I could get some information also how they really how could they run the department very successfully so compared to any other the program, which is a. Jewish
Judaic studies.
Yeah, studies, and then also we have a. What else we have? I forgot. Yeah. So we have some other ethnic the programs. So this is one of the best, the successful programs we in Brooklyn College.
That Judaic studies.
Yeah. So the next pages. So I talked about a little bit about Brooklyn College. The last year. So finally, actually, we have Asian study minor, because before we had this program before, but it was not very successful, and then not many students really know about this program. But last year, actually, we, as an Asian faculty, had a big meeting every month, and then we approached this program to be the majors. So the first step actually is becoming a minor program. So I'm sure we are getting more students who is interested about Asian cultures now, and then we try to make all the brochure, and then we try to make also the posters, so we just spread all the school. So we got many response because the students actually interesting, but they didn't know that how to take this class. So it was kind of the first thing we prepare for the international student, not only for interested student also, but also the American student who is interested in Asian cultures. Okay, next pages. Also, we have a very interesting program too here. So, Brooklyn College itself, we have the study abroad programs. These people can go to China I believe they're paying about $2,800 something, and they cover all the, you know, the airfare, hotel, and then you take all the class, you can have all the tours, all the, like six different cities, you can travel there. So we have amazing program, but I didn't know that before I started making this documentary. I never, sorry to say that, but I was never interested in. But now once I started, I was really amazed. So that called Next Pages. So winter also, you know, we have also another program going to India. So this is also, you know, the amazing, you know, the program. So as a Brooklyn College student, they have a lot of chance, you know, can learn about Asian cultures. So they look at this one, China, India. So they can go for 3 weeks. So for the India, also China. Okay, next pages. Okay, so can skip and then okay. So this is actually, you know, this another number, because you see the red, the one here. This is like a New York area, which has the Asian American Study Program. So we have about 30. Can you go back to the one more previous one? Oh, you can go back. Okay. So from the Association for Asian American Studies 2007, there's a 32 Asian American Study Program, and then 20 Asian American Study Programs within department. Also, I believe this is the only Asian American Studies Institute here. So this is 2007. So maybe now it is 2009. I'm sure we have a couple more the centers and the institute. But the CUNY has the only Asian American Study Institute by 2007. This is a really amazing thing about CUNY. As a Asian, we should really appreciate the CUNY then. Okay, go to the next pages. So I pointed because this is a very successful, you know, the school who has which has all the, you know, Asian American program. So Hunt College, Queens College, Columbia University, and then New York University is there. Let's see next pages. So if you see the, you know, the there's a lot of Ivy League the school, the university has these also Asian American study programs. So this is also interesting. Next pages. Okay. Can go back. Okay, so back to Brooklyn College. If you see this here, if this picture, you see a lot of Asian faces here. Because usually the Brooklyn College is kind of very famous to the China and then Korea, because this is one of the best TV school. Maybe they can afford it, probably. Not only for the money, the tuition, but also for the quality of quality of the class, you know. So once a year, actually, we invite the faculty from different countries. So this is, I think, 2 years ago, we had a visiting faculty from, I think, Shanghai. So these all the faculty came from the Shanghai University, something. So next page. So also, you know, the faculty who is the graduate deputy, he's visiting China every year to have a lecture. So he has a big, great understanding about Chinese, also Asian culture. Let's go to the next pages. So he has also every year having lecture there. Next pages. Also, we have another like Professor Hashimi. She came from Pakistan, and then she has also a lot of understanding about like Indians, also not only for Indian, but also for also general Asian student. So also me and the Kathy. So we sorry, I didn't know that. So go to next pages. Yeah, next we also have a very great understanding about Asian culture. So when Asian students come to Brooklyn College in TV and radio, usually they will get help very easily from faculty, staff, also even students from themselves, because we have a lot of bilingual Asian American students, because they can speak like Chinese, they can speak Korean, they can speak Japanese, also one guy from Nepal. Also, you just all the faces here. Look at all, a lot of the Asian faces. They're all MAP students. So this is about TV and radio. Go to next pages. Okay, so then this is Brooklyn College. Next pages. Yeah, that's okay. So then I have to say the last word. So I believe that the Asian Cultural Studies program is what we want, and then also, and is also what we need here at Brooklyn College. Because as we see all this number, because Broome College is a public school, first of all, and then we have a lot of Asian students, and then the generally American students want to have a better understanding about Asian culture. Besides, I believe 60% of our world population is Asian, so without understanding Asian, it's hard to be a world leader these days. So we should have an Asian American study program for college. That's my ending. So, Kathy.
Just to keep going where Young is at, when Young entered Brooklyn College as an international student, he had many fellow students who were in the same category as he was. There seemed to be a world within a world where foreign students and domestic students mingled inside the same classes. Excuse me, I have a cold. As he went through both the undergraduate and graduate studies programs at BC, he became more and more aware that the students in the program didn't really know or understand the administrative or academic procedures that were affecting them in one way or another. So he decided to propose this documentary, and he did so that there could be something tangible, something that would show the students where they could locate assistance and advice throughout CUNY. We focused on the Asian popularity for two reasons. One was because Young is Asian and from South Korea and has firsthand experience, and two, because currently there is a movement within CUNY to establish an Asian studies program at all the campuses. I'm sorry. While this particular documentary is not focused on the latter, it is a stepping stone toward making additional documentaries showcasing the Asian studies programs and other diversity programs and movements within the CUNY system. So, once the grant came through, there was no turning back. And when Young asked for my input on the footage, I decided that writing the narration would work best for me. I've always enjoyed writing for my personal satisfaction. And so the challenge to fit words to Young's pictures was a bit daunting to me at first. Somehow, after viewing the footage and repeatedly watching the visual editing process, the story started to come together for me. I will always be grateful to Young for giving me an opportunity to express myself in this manner. It is quite a satisfying experience being a part of a project that shows diversity of our university and its openness towards all who enter the CUNY system. Of course, I realize that there are many obstacles that students in particular must face while furthering their education, and my sincere hope is that somehow, and in some way, this documentary will make a difference in at least one person's life. What we discovered during the research of this documentary was surprising to us. We learned that CUNY had many avenues in place that could help international students as well as American students of foreign descent. Many of these programs are not as well known as one would hope, but nevertheless, the information and assistance is out there. We decided that we would produce this first documentary to showcase the diversity of Brooklyn College and bring to the surface the knowledge that CUNY cares about all its students, and that the Asian group focused on here is among many groups from every ethnic origin who can benefit from these resources. The growing Asian population throughout CUNY is yet another reason that Young decided it was time to make this documentary. There is an Asian population of approximately 14%, which now attends a CUNY school. There is a need for more resources, courses, and administrative assistance to help this group of students in their quest for higher education. This documentary also attempts to follow a few students, some of the faculty and administration involved with Asian students, while they maneuver through their courses, through their college administrative requirements, and their socialization process on campus. This informative documentary is a look at various viewpoints that tell an everyday simple story about simple things that confront students on an everyday basis. This documentary is simplistically expressed, and our hope is that people will become more aware of the obstacles such as language and cultural differences that people face every day, and would encourage others to take a further look into innovative and progressive resources, courses, and other opportunities that would lend a more permanent and positive approach toward welcoming Asian Americans and Asian international students into the CUNY world. This is our world within, and we live it every day. Thank you.
So, Kathy, you should have a question.
Yeah, why not? Do you want to take questions and answers questions from the audience? Anyone have anything they'd like to ask? Yes, sir.
Well, what's the current situation right now with the Brooklyn College administration wanting to make make Asian studies into a major?
Well, it's an ongoing struggle right now. There's a group of faculty members who wish to turn the minor, Asian studies minor, into a major. And they're running into obstacles with funding. They're running into obstacles with space. They have a call for it from students, but there's not enough administrative help towards accomplishing this. And so what they were trying to do is reach out to the community. Maybe some congresspeople or someone like that would be interested in funding an initial start off to this program so that they can offer it to the many students of the Asian cultures.
In addition, in your presentation, you mentioned mm-hmm. Hunter College as one of the places of Asian American studies.
Yes.
It is, but also the administration really doesn't support it. It actually wants to get rid of the program. You're able to apply as a minor, but 2 years ago, they actually took it off the table as a minor because the president herself wanted to not fund it. There's some trouble going on.
Yeah, because the student, actually, the number of students is very important, because the trouble is usually, you have to have a really good advertisement. You have to advertise your program, because otherwise students just don't know how to study even Asian American program, even though it's there. So that's why we actually argue and we discussed about those issues to new provost, because he actually wanted help to establish the new program. He understand, and then, but trouble is this is the economic crisis, so he tried to hold it now. So last month, actually, we had a meeting with all Asian faculty, with the new provost. So we actually, told him our hope. Not only for hope, it was kind of planned, actually. We had a little plan, so we actually explained that. He's very positive about that. But
the trouble again, he needs funding.
Right, the funding is a big issue. But I'm sure it will happen soon.
I hope so. We hope it happens. Mm. Anyone else? Yes?
Are there currently any Asian or Asian American clubs at Brooklyn College where students can get together and talk about these issues?
That's a good question. I'm unaware of one. I know that there's a Caribbean club and a Dominican club and a Black American club. African American club, but I don't know of any Asian American clubs at Brooklyn College. And I'm often encourage the students to start one on their own. I know that our graduate programs are like that. They have clubs where the students can meet with each other, and there are a lot of Asians in that club and in that program. And they have a sort of a club, quote unquote club. But they do socialize, and they do get together, and they do express their feelings to one another, and they do have gatherings and things like that. They help each other with productions, things like that. But nothing sanctioned as an actual club at Brooklyn College for Asian Americans, no.
But one of them is actually Chinese, the Christian, the club actually is there. That's actually very active now, except that...
It's Christian.
But it's a Chinese Christian, so it's part of Asian... related, so that's maybe the club you mentioned, but
it's not well known.
Exactly, because students just don't know that, So as my research, I saw that we had some Korean clubs before, so we had the Taekwondo clubs, some kind of the cultural things there before, but I think once student graduate, it's all gone. Actually, they don't really next the group. So 1 year you have it, next year it's gone. So it's kind of a come and go situation.
So. That's why it's so important for alumni to be involved with what goes on with the students, to help us to get things like the Asian Studies program off the ground, particularly at Brooklyn College. I mean, there's like Young pointed out, there's so many more Asian cultures in Brooklyn than there ever was before, that there's no reason why outside help wouldn't want to see this happen and to learn about their own culture and to learn about their own history of where their descendants, descendants and ancestors came from. I mean, it's vitally important that alumni and outside people get involved in order to fund these programs. Yes?
Since the film is so heavily focused on Brooklyn College, are there any plans to sort of get the film out to the student body so that they can see it and maybe realize that there are other students that they can talk to and maybe get that motivation to start a club or lobby for Asian American Studies as a major.
It's a good idea. We should hold a screening. Maybe Young and I will do that.
Actually, it was on air, the CUNY TV. So, but it will be on air again soon.
But on campus, he means, so that we, you know, encourage the students.
Yeah, I'll show him another the screening from college itself. So when I made, when we started make this documentary, because it was tough to have some interview, because a lot of people actually were very defense. And then also they thought we are making kind of exposé types of documentary, which is not
controversial.
Yeah, we were working for the Brooklyn College. We love Brooklyn College, so we want to make something for good actually. So we had to spend quite a lot of time to explain our project, and then they agreed to be on camera later. So we had all these interviews.
We trust and believe in the CUNY system because we see the product of it. We see our students graduate with great education through the core program and through the graduate programs, and it's a wonderful source for all people. But they do give you a hard time sometimes. One of my main concerns was international students, when they come in, they really have a hard time because they don't know the process. They don't know the way things work, the procedures, how they go, what's out there for them, how they get the most help. They have immigration over their head. They want to go home and visit their mother. They can't. You know, their father or their parents, whatever. They can't do that because something holds them back in immigration. And there should be a place like the international office that would help them to do that. That would help them to get the paperwork done, help them to get the service they need to put them. And also when they graduate, you know, when they have to get job training visas and things like that. They should be more actively involved, in my opinion, towards the student body, especially international and Asian students in particular.
Because most of Asian American students are the bilingual, so they do speak their mother tongue language at home to their parents. So they usually understand the foreign student who doesn't speak English fluently when they come here. So they are actually kind of brother and sister for the foreign student. So when they come here, usually they help them to adjust into American system. So that's actually really helpful. So the more Asian American students means we will have more the foreign students get help. So right. It's good to have.
Absolutely. Yes?
Maybe this question might be very, go back to the fundamental issue of Asian studies. I want to know, why do we need Asian studies? Because we have a lot of Asian students here, or what is the need of, this Asian studies in this society? Because I was in the undergraduate and I took the whole courses. I learned Western history and Black history, African American history, because those, the history and culture were so influential in this, foundation of this country. Because, it's like the Enlightenment, industrial revolutions, how it influenced, these United States. And African American is like, we learned about, slavery, the history of a kind. It's very involved in this society. But what is the need for Asian studies?
I can only give you my personal opinion, if I may, okay? And because I have no background in the research to answer that question properly. I can only tell you what I think. And I think it's needed because you should know the culture. Asian American born students, students born in America from Asian parents or descendants, know nothing about their original cultures and their original backgrounds. And I believe it should be available to them. I believe that they should know and explore every avenue that they can. And Asians are a very big part of history in America. And they were slaves too. And do people know that? Is it widely known? I don't think so. Not in today's day and age, and it should be. I mean, they touch on it in history books and in elementary, high school, and things like that, but I don't think it's broadened or given the right horizon in college, or the right atmosphere in college to go beyond and to study all of those things and to know more and more about how did Asians come here? How did they get involved in America? What did they do? What don't they know? The people that are raised here, what do they know about their countries? And I think it's very important. I think it's vitally important to learn about one's own heritage.
And then, you know, the first Asian who came to this country was the Filipino, 1780s. I think this is from the Wikipedia. I just read it yesterday. It's really funny fact. She married to the Eskimo in 1780s something. It was amazing, like almost like 300.
Wow.
You know, the.
I didn't know that.
It's quite a long time ago, but you know, that's like the fact that those that Asian actually was here before actually Columbus came here almost. So this is the country we respect all the diversity, or we respect all the different ethnic groups, because that's why we can live together here. So if you don't understand Asian, think about it. The 60% of the world population is Asian. How can you be a world leader? So how can you understand? How can you face your daily life without, you know, the facing Asian culture? Then, okay, you are the general American student, let's say. Then, if you don't have any idea about Asian culture or Asian background, then you might have culture shock in this country, because you might have all like 10 Asian students instead of American student. That's gonna happen, maybe. So I think we want to prepare those things also to the future world leader.
Okay, well said.
Regarding the CUNY diversity grant, the amount that you received, was it enough to cover the entire project, the production, post-production, or did you have to seek other sources of funding outside of Brooklyn College, or was it Brooklyn College to do this project?
We used some of our own money to fund the project. It wasn't quite enough.
Because you know, this is a real late. Because I just talk about the many hours we spend, because we interview about 50 people, and then we spend about 30 days shooting. But the most time, you know, the MFA student helped me, also Kathy helped me in I work, so we didn't really pay for the editor, or the camera person, also
labor.
Yeah, because really we didn't pay. Also, we borrowed most of the high-end equipment from the TV and radio department. If you want to rent one of those cameras, you have to pay like $200 per day. So think about it, 30 days shooting, you need a camera for 30 days. So I'm sure it'd be cheaper once you borrow for 30 days, but that's quite a lot of money to borrow those equipment. But I didn't pay for any money for the equipment. Since I'm working with TV and radio, I used all my equipment as free. So the $5,000 usually I cover the students is like a CA. And then also I pay their tapes, like very the minor. The expense. So most of the money just go to the students, because they're learning and they're shooting, they're helping us. So it was kind of win-win situation. So it was not enough, but it was okay to make a 30-minute
documentary. Well, we did, because we made a simple documentary, so it was enough just to get us through that, yes.
What channels have you, sent this documentary to? Have you sent it to the President Kim at your campus, as well as Diversity Administration at CUNY Central to view the film?
Yes, we did. We sent copies of it, and we have heard no feedback. And we've been waiting for feedback, but we haven't heard it.
Did you get any feedback from people who might have seen it on CUNY TV at all?
We had a little bit of feedback from one of our faculty members who watched it, and it was a critical feedback, because she felt that we didn't deal enough with the foreign student issue. She's Hispanic, as I tried to explain to her, we weren't doing that as yet. This is just a beginning documentary, yep. A simple documentary to open the door up to further studies and further research in this particular area. But she wanted us to do differently, and we couldn't bring out all the controversy in this particular DVD.
Do you plan on doing a follow-up?
I hope so.
Yeah, absolutely, because I'd like to, because this is kind of my first documentary about Asian American study, so I just learned so far. So this is my learning process. I just maybe passed step one, so my second step would be, now I have a better understanding than before, so I'd like to make a different approach. Because I really want to focus on the student, because I really want to see their problem, and then I want to show their problem, and then I want to follow their process, how they solve the problem. Because then, before I actually approach those problems, I need to better understand about Asian Americans' problem, or so Asian Americans need it. So I think I'm kind of ready to know this problem. So I think we can.
And secretly, I was hoping to follow up on the Asian Studies program that gets started in Brooklyn College that we're hoping will happen soon. And I would like to follow that process as well, to follow the Asian Studies program that they'll start in Brooklyn College when it turns from minor to major. I would like to help that process along to turn from minor to major.
The current minor that they have, how long has it been in existence so far? Two semesters now?
No, I think longer than two semesters. I think
it's been a couple of years.
But the trouble is there's no staff who's involved in that
minor program.
No funding. So just like a couple of volunteer faculty, they put together those you know, the class, so they applied. So that's why, you know, we request the maybe step hours, also some the real funding. Then actually you can go to the next step to establish the real majors. So it's going to be long run.
With faculty from all over. I mean, there are faculty in place now willing to teach these courses. You know, we just need the money to hire.
So the great thing about this now is the Nancy Hager, she was the acting provost but last year. And then she's actually in our committee, and then she's helping. And she's trying to introduce this, you know, the Asian faculty group to all the, you know, the administrators. So I think she's a.
Nancy Hager and Jennifer Bain are currently on the diversity committee at Brooklyn College, and they're starting all different projects. And we're hoping that this is one that they'll focus on.
Any other questions for our speakers tonight? Not, let's give them a round of applause.
Thank you. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Mm-hmm.